pants. It's me, Flakey, and today I'm gonna... Oh! And today I'm gonna be reacting to Don't Hug Me, I'm... three videos of DHIS. First one is by my boy, my favorite YouTube channel of all time, Dead Meat. Then, we are gonna do a song from CG5 of DHIS. And then, we're gonna do a song from Rocket Music. So let's get straight into the first video first, which is Dead Meat Kill Cam! Don't hug me, I'm scared! Damn it, I can't even... Okay, there we go. Put him in your PS5, please!
Welcome to the Kill Count, where we tally up the victims and all our favorite, well, I don't know, man. We are in uncharted territories here with the SAG strike. But hey, we're trying new shit, which is why we're looking at Don't Hug Me, I'm Scared, a British YouTube series consisting of six episodes, most of them released from 2014 to 16. We've covered a couple web series before, like Crypt TV's Look See and Sunny Family Cult, but those were both more or less straightforward horror stories, as weird as Look See could get sometimes.
Hey.
Oh, and by the way, bitch, you never call me! In contrast, Don't Hug Me, I'm Scared is its fucking thing entirely. On the surface, it's a riff on kids' TV shows where each episode has a lesson, only they all end up getting dark and weird. With that premise, it'd be easy to have le random humor. But Don't Hug Me's weirdness is inspired, and the darkness has a point. The show doesn't give explicit answers for what it's about, but you'll get the gist of it at least, and diving deeper rewards you with a solid and ultimately satisfying story. At least, that's how I felt after watching MatPat's film theory videos about it. He did a great two-parter on the web series that shed light on what it means. Chelsea and I have always been fans of Don't Hug Me. We were quoting it back on our old show, Drunk Disney.
Don't touch me!
Don't touch me!
It's just got so much thought and care put into it through and through.
I
the production design
like
is incredible, with everything handmade and bespoke for the show. That comes courtesy of creators Becky Sloan and Joseph Pelling, two Brits who just won a production design BAFTA for the follow-up Don't Hug Me TV series on the BBC, which I haven't had the chance to watch yet. They met at Kingston University. Sloan was a fine arts student making big physical props, while Pelling was an animation student, alongside Baker Terry, who does most of the voice acting, and who co-wrote all the episodes after the first one. Thanks to their combined expertises, Don't Hug Me has amazing practical puppet effects, and various types of animation as the situation calls.
Yeah.
Hell, it even winds up in a more traditional real-world setting. And throughout all the turns it takes, it delivers one seriously catchy song after another. The show has constant surprises, so I definitely recommend you take 33 minutes and watch the whole series before you watch this video. It's truly a work of art. A creative work of art. Let's see how many things die in it. The series begins with an episode released as Don't Hug Me, I'm Scared 12 years ago, in summer 2011. We're in a prop-filled kitchen where three friends sit at a table. Red guy, yellow guy, and duck. They're good lads. A sketchbook flips open and starts singing at them about how to live deliciously or creatively. At first, the lesson's a hard sell for these guys.
I use my head to express myself.
That's actually important.
I use my head to express myself.
But they keep at it, and soon they're seeing clouds of past kill counts, like Cujo, frogs, and, Scream 6, maybe? Unfortunately for Yellow Guy, the most childlike of the gang, he seems to be doing creative things all wrong.
Green is not a creative color.
It's only the first sign something's amiss. The second is when they flip into tune mode and reveal a film set behind them, ushering in a montage of madness that sees a glitter heart and the longest mullet I've ever seen on Yellow Guy, looking like Marge Simpson with her hair down. This experimental jazz-infused acid trip ends with a sketch pad all creative out.
Now that's all agreed. To never be creative again.
And you know what? Fuck it! Let's put Sketchpad on the count. The rules for this one are that there are no rules. I mean, the little lady said she was donezo, then flopped back and folded. Toss her in the recycling bin. So yeah, that was the first episode. Pretty weird. We had a sketchbook, voiced by co-creator Becky Sloan, teaching that creativity can be done a right and a wrong way. Not the usual message for kids. And damn, did my blood run cold when she calmly clapped back at Red Guy.
I use my head to express myself.
It's the one and only Nico Double G.
The short was made by Sloan and Pelling under their artist tag, This Is It. There's a video by them on their channel, predating Don't Hug Me, called Bad Things That Could Happen. It features a lot of the same kind of practical puppetry, depicting dark situations with a wry sense of humor. Don't Hug Me, I'm Scared, retroactively called Creativity, became popular online, so they pursued their original idea of making it a series. The second episode was supported by Random Acts, a public arts fund by the UK's Channel 4. Sloan and Pelling turned down offers of more money from bigger companies, so they could keep keep making the show exactly the way they wanted to, which is awesome. Episode 2 came out 2.5 years later in January 2014. Now the bros are in the living room. Apparently on the same day, June 19th. It's a whole fucking thing. Red Guy and Duck look more or less the same, but let me tell you, time and budget were good to Yellow Guy. Speaking of time, that's what this episode's all about.
There's always time for a song.
Who's that? It's Tony the Talking Clock, voiced by Baker Terry, who also voices Duck and Yellow Guy, as well as a whole bunch of other characters who will talk and sing songs at us. Tony starts singing about time, and the lyrics quickly hint towards its decomposing qualities. The seriousness of time's never-ending march moves Tony so much, he starts singing like a South Park character.
Let's go on a journey through time.
He gives him a history lesson, with a strange fixation on cobbles, and then things head out to the woods to get weirder. Tony starts being even meaner than that sketch pad, and we meet Yellow Guy's creepy-ass dad named Roy. Aw, I want to dip his little nose in some ranch and eat it up. Except, never mind. Not sure if that'd be ranch. Tony would rather talk about fishes and his stupid face than let Duck try to figure out the true nature of time.
You mean time's just a construct of human perception, an illusion created by...
Broke Yellow Guy! Damn it, Tony! Actually, he really broke him. He makes him and his friends age like they were put in a temporal microwave. It's honestly disturbing.
It's out of my hands, I'm only a cog. Don't worry, I'm sure you'll be fine. But eventually, everyone runs out of time.
Hell of a kids' TV show these guys are running. When this second video also proved successful, a Kickstarter was launched to make a full series with the goal of raising about 100,000 quid. The campaign promised a show that would answer life's questions like, where do dogs live? And why is this pillowcase full of ham? I like that Sloan and Pelling lend their sense of humor to so much of what they do. To support the Kickstarter, they released 2 terrifying analog horror ransom videos.
If you're watching this, then we need your help.
Then on the Kickstarter's behind-the-scenes featurette, they included repetitive use of crafting B-roll that eventually gets painful, and more inaccurate descriptions of the show.
Don't Worry, I'm Scared is about 3 best friends who go on an adventure to find a magic pirate ship and save the day.
It even had sketches of and voice recording sessions for completely non-existent characters. I love it. The Kickstarter succeeded, and episode 3 was released 8 months later in October of 2014. The guys are in the great outdoors, and also possibly missing, according to that sign. Maybe they're just trying to get away from all the weirdos in their house and enjoy this delicious chicken picnic. Duck's a little protective of that chicknic. And sure, we'll add a cartoon butterfly to the kill count. Why the hell not? Yellow Guy's an empath, so he runs crying up a tree. He's found by Shrigno, another pesky bee.
And it's a baby pigeon.
Okay, I have some questions. You like to ask them, though, because this butterfly is already singing about love, the topic of episode 3. It's a nice, peaceful song that feels less menacing than the first 2. But don't worry, it'll get there soon enough, after things get animated in a psychedelic summer of love style. Yellow Guy learns about love from Shrignold and all his friends, including...
Cloudy!
They love everything about Yellow Guy. His look, his voice, his touch.
Harder.
Yellow Guy's eager to love, but eventually gets a bit too Brick Tamlin about it.
I love this tree, and I love this stick, and I love...
No, that's not how it's done.
They tell her, the yellow feller, that he needs somebody to love fun. And it won't be his friends, since they're too busy eating bloody cakes and raw chicken that have flies on it. The talk of Yellow Guy's special one starts sounding religious and then outright culty when they reveal their idol Malcolm, the King of Love. And they're gonna feed Malcolm the Yellow Guy? Oh, no, just grab him. Oh, that's not bad. The King's Cult does involve a name change and some brain scrubbing, though, so even with the promise of a special one, it's all too much for Yellow Guy. He snaps out of it and is found by his friends, who do love him after all.
We've bought you the last boiled egg to cheer you up.
But then history repeats itself when the egg hatches and Duck swats that larva to death. This episode's credits feature King Malcolm getting the full Wicker Man treatment. No doubt the creators thought of that classic British horror film when they were writing this episode featuring a cult. Episode 4, which has always been my favorite, was released after a 5-month gap in spring of 2015. The boys are in what looks to be a game room, with lots of fun things to distract them from looking at that picture of Yellow Guy and his dad. Their game asks them a real brain buster, but instead of learning the answer from a globe, the analog world gets invaded by a computer.
Stop all the damage.
downloaded.
This clever computer boy can tell them everything, except what they want to know. It knows all about numbers and oats, especially oats. Must have a fiber connection. This computer won't stand for younger models either. It's here to steamroll these consumers with a bunch of personal questions. And don't you dare try to interrupt.
Shut up!
Don't touch me!
What? Turns out touching that board's the key to an existential meltdown, Red Guy. The characters glitch into the computer's digital home, a sometimes nauseating place.
Wow. The computer.
The PC assures them they're still real, they're just controlling digital avatars. Good luck teaching them VR one day. Though they initially came here seeking specific knowledge, the guys are told that they can only do three things in this digital world. Look at various infographs, dress up in digital style, or go out digital dancing, which, hey, that was fun. Still, three content streams doesn't seem like good business, especially when one of them runs out of content right away. The doom scrolling becomes too much for real-world Red Guy, who tries to control or delete his way out of there, all while Roy creepily watches from the corner. What the fuck, Roy? Since when is this hereditary? Red Guy follows a cord coming out the back of the computer, and it leads him into a room that gives me nightmares. It's a lo-fi version of their show. And that puppeteer was not expecting it. It's enough to blow Red Guy's mind, which I'll count as a kill. I mean, the guy's head blew up. Gotta count it. Besides, counting him makes sense when the next episode starts and he's not there. Episode 5 came out after another 6 months in October of 2015. Duck and Yellow Guy are in their kitchen again, but it's way bigger and more stocked than it was in episode 1. Yellow Guy notices too.
Something's different.
Then again, he might just be talking about Red Guy's absence, which Duck notes as well when a picture on their fridge changes. That can't be good. Before they can ponder where their trace amigo is, their kitchen
that's
items
exactly
break into an unsophisticated song.
Who's
that on drums? Is that a bread boy?
I'm a bread boy.
Ha, I thought so. The can, the bread, and this big-ass steak mofo start jabbing forks at him and singing the praises of healthy foods. Well, healthy foods when they're Roy's brand. It's really hard to pick a favorite song in the series. I think my number one is still Computer, but let me tell you, this one's been sneaking up on me. I especially like the funky keyboard that gets real low.
What's that? A tasty snack! You don't want to go and eat a snack like that!
And the steak and spinach can have my favorite voices from Terry and Sloan. The song and dance gets interrupted by a red phone ringing, and it ain't Khrushchev calling about the bomb. Duck answers it and starts waking up like he were in a Philip K. Duck story. It makes him uninterested in the menacing foods with their clumsy metaphors and their springy food or regular tetradecagon. The song takes it to the fridge, and it's enough to make Duck snap. He knocks over the camera and tries to escape the show, only to wind up captured and learning that the show must go on. The kitchen objects tell Yellow Guy to eschew the pie and white sauce, try this canned food. He won't know that it's his friend Duck being torn apart and eaten by a giant can. Duck's been canned from the show and canned his food. Should that be in the microwave? When this latest song ends, it looks like Yellow Guy's been forced to eat Duck. Holy shit. Before the episode ends, the phone rings again, and the credits suggest it's the Red Guy calling his friends from his freedom outside of the show's studio. The grand finale took 8 months to arrive, dropping in 2016 on, naturally, June 19th. By now, Yellow Guy's all alone, crying about his friends.
Good night, guys.
Oh, wait, maybe he is
sad. He tries to sweep the sadness away, but his desk lamp won't let him be. It wants to sing about dreams, beginning the final nightmare for Yellow Guy. It's the worst song, intentionally, with Yellow Guy wailing while crude animation plays. Yellow Guy can't escape it, not even after he wakes up. As the lamp taunts him, he drowns in oil in his bed, and I'll add him to our weird-ass kill count. After that, the series shifts into widescreen with the real world. We're at work with the Red Guy, whose monotonous speech is revealed to be a staple of Red Guys everywhere.
Can you file these files, please?
In fact, Red Guy seems to be the most creative one of the bunch.
I am a file, and you put documents in me, and,
Red Guy's memorable monotone comes from co-creator Joe Pellet, who also voiced the clever smart computer he got. Red Guy's peers poo-poo his silly Billy thoughts without a ballyhoo among them. Okay. And when he tackles an open mic night with a rendition of the first episode's creative song, they damn near start a riot.
Really,
the only one who doesn't boo him is Roy, sitting in the back. A That's when Red Guy starts seeing himself in a creative world again. Or actually, for the first time, if you agree with MatPat's theory that this real-world stuff is the start of things chronologically. The theory goes that Red Guy was someone who wanted to do something creative, only to be told no by everyone around him. Roy saw this and agreed to fund a kids' TV show for Red Guy, as long as his son could be a part of it. But gradually, Roy let commercial interests take over, until Red Guy left the show out of frustration and the whole thing fell apart. I know it's just a theory, a film theory, but it's a solid one. I recommend MatPat's videos to hear the whole thing. Right now, Red Guy's confronting the bastardized version of his dream TV show. He tries to save Yellow Guy, only to take him down a path of traumatic memories.
You make me die!
Not quite, Yellow Guy. I didn't count you in the time episode. After a cavalcade of the series' sinister antagonists, new faces jump in and out, and the place starts sounding like TMBG's fingertips.
I'm Matt here, and I'm Matt here, and it's my best friend!
Both of those voices were cameos. While Sloan, Pelling, and Terry did most of the voices throughout the series, the Magnet is voiced by Thomas Ridgewell, aka YouTuber Tom Scott, whose kill won the Golden Chainsaw in the Dude Bro Party Massacre kill count. Although we failed to point him out. Sorry, guy. Tom Scott donated £5,000 to the Don't Hug Me Kickstarter, which earned him an EP credit in episodes 3 through 6, and a voice cameo here. Meanwhile, the Shovel is voiced by Kellen Goff, a prolific voice actor who's been in several Five Nights at Freddy's films. As Red Guy tries to fix things, a long arm extends from the shadows to place upon
Shout out to you, Kellen
Sorry,
Goff!
Dude, it's not your friend the Yellow Guy. It's Roy. No one wants Roy's hand on their shoulder. Red Guy does his old trick of following the cord, and after wondering what will happen when he pulls the giant plug, he fucks around and finds out. It creates a brand new day, literally, with palette-swapped versions of the three main characters. They're actually their favorite colors now, as they mentioned in the first episode. Yellow Guy even gets to be green. Hopefully this new sketch pad will be nicer to them as the series starts anew. How many rule-breaking kills did I count in this episode? Let's find out and get do the numbers.
He keeps on getting creative with this. How? I love when he gets creative with these, yo. Oh look, there's the clock eye. You gonna get that?
Oh my god, what happened to me?
Hey James, I actually had a quick question and oh, you're a puppet.
Dude, I know!
Whoa!
Wait, does that make me felt me?
Ew, gross, no! Whatever, it doesn't matter. I was actually working on a new kill count.
I didn't authorize that.
Hey, look, shut up! I'm still confused as to sometimes what kills count and what kills don't count.
Look, he's a puppet
well, I can
this
help you
one.
With that.
Great!
Cool.
With a song!
God damn it.
There are rules you need to know when you want to count kills up.
Yes, what rules must I know?
I'll tell you if you shut the fuck up. Rule breaker songs and animals. Like if you should count Penny's mommy.
Yes, her death made my heart sad.
Too bad, because she wasn't human. We only count humanoids, animals or creatures.
But didn't you count Bruce the shark?
That was mostly a joke, not standard procedure.
Wait, Puppet James, didn't you just count a butterfly a few minutes ago in this very episode?
Yep.
Well, doesn't that break your own rules?
These rules are for regular episodes. This one is fucking weird!
I respect your accredited degree, WG.
Oh my god, James and Denise!
Doesn't that break
You're making
your own
me
rules?
Laugh,
These
yo.
Rules are for regular episodes. This one is fucking weird! Rule 2 deals with infections! Viruses and becoming zombies.
Oh yeah, we count them twice, right?
Only if we saw them die previously. Which brings
what
us to rule number
hell?
3.
I gotta pee.
We don't count unseen backstory deaths. It's gotta be characters we know.
Get out of here!
Or a flashback of someone we already met. When there's a whole room of kills that make the scream.
Oh my gosh!
The simplest way to count them is to put that work all on Josh.
Oh, come on. Even in the song?
One last rule for now.
Oh, God.
And this
oh
one's
my
very
God.
No skin, no soul, no service. Never, ever count a bastard skelly.
Bastard. Skellies.
Bastard.
Skellies.
Oh, my God.
mountain rules. But don't feel too encumbered. Just make
what
sure you always finish by saying, let's get to the numbers.
That was so funny. I love
that.
That
one was a doozy. I counted 6 kills in Don't Hug Me, I'm Scared. Although, maybe I should have counted the aging kills in time, too.
My teddy bear funny bone.
Whatever, this thing is all messed up. I'm not even sure what to do about a pie chart. Oh yeah, I guess that works. Colors are fine. With 6 episodes across the web series, that left us with an average of 1 kill per episode. Easy. I'll give the golden chainsaw for coolest kill to Duck. That giant can runs amok with his guts, which probably couldn't have smelled too good on set. The machete for lamest kill will go to the sketchbook, who bullied the yellow guy so hard it died of exhaustion. And that's it. Don't Hug Me, I'm Scared is an incredible web series that released its last episode in 2016. Thankfully, the creators would get to continue the series with a BBC show consisting of another 6 episodes. If this kill count does well, maybe I'll look at that too. But until then,
yes!
James A. Janice.
Hey,
thanks a lot for watching the kill count for Don't Hug Me, I'm Scared. We are officially in the weird era of kill counts. Who made this wonderful puppet, Zoran?
Of course it would be my good friend Gina DeVivo, who makes all the things for any of my kill counts, and now she's made this amazing puppet there. Just James.
Yes.
Just James.
Thank you, Gina, and big thanks to Fiona, our executive assistant, for the decoration on set. Did you notice that Billy was turned into Red Guy?
Oh, wow.
Do you want to play a game? Every day you go fishing with your mates, but now there's fish everywhere.
Flea!
I really like this video. Go like this video, go watch this video, I highly recommend it. Oh my goodness. James A. Denise, I'm definitely gonna like that song that you just did. That was so catchy, it was so... I don't know how he does it! Anyway, next is CG5, the DHS. DHIS song. Here it is. Don't Hug Me, I'm Scared. Let's get straight into it. Father's Day. 3 pawn, 2 pawn, 1 pawn. Let's go. Oh.
Okay. This is my creative side. I express myself. Come with me, look at the sky. Take a flight of fancy slides. Project across the screen to my gifted mind. Play the flame, failing fast. Follow financial organization. Sometime, listen to the rain.
Oh.
Have you an idea in mind? Multi-flavored fiction.
Okay.
Can you hear the voice inside telling you to listen? Canceled is your fancy flight. Glittered hearts and fears alight. Just a little more manipulation. It's okay.
Thank you.
defeated to a chamber. It's easy as 1, 2, 3, charge your style of dancing.
If I'm locked down, the wonder I'm will soon be gone. There's so many dangerous things around.
I really like that. I recommend this song to anyone. And I recommend the song Father's Day to anyone as well. Alright, so that was it for me, my bear fans. That was just me, your bear, your homie, Flakey Winter, reacting to Kill Count, Don't Hide Me, I'm Scared by Dead Meat, Father's Day by CP5, and Don't Hug Me, I'm Scared by Rocket Gaming. And if you like my reaction to the Kill Count of Don't Hug Me, I'm Scared by Dead Meat, and Father's Day by CP5, and Don't Hug Me, I'm Scared by Rocket Gaming, why not hit that subscribe button, hit that like button, hit that notification bell anytime I upload a new video, and comment down below if you would want a season 2 of, like, Don't Hug Me, I'm Scared, because I feel like because what they did at the end, where they showed the book, and I wanted to know what the hell is in that book that the yellow guy wanted to show them. Like, what was it? Like, is it an answer to who's behind all of it? I wanted to know, but apparently the duck guy took the batteries out of the yellow guy, and damn it! Like, I want to know. So please, whoever's behind this show, please give us a season 2 for Don't Hang Me, I'm Scared, because I would really like a season 2 of this, because this was really good. I like the animation style, and the songs are catchy. I really like how each episode is based on, like, topics like time, art, creativity, love, technology, healthy, dreams, jobs, friendship, family, transportation, and electricity. I love those, I just love it how they just use these episodes for just our favorite topics, and they twist it up a bit, too, to make it so dark and gritty, and I love that. It's so amazing that I actually got to watch the show, and thank you for whoever showed up to the live stream of me reacting to Don't Hide Me, I'm Scared, to 3 to 12, because this show really does deserve a second season. Because, hey, if Hell of a Boss could get a second season, it's only fair that Don't Hug Me, I'm Scared can get a second season. Because I feel like this should get a second season because all of us are wondering what the hell was in that book. Like, that's the main mystery of the first season that we saw of Don't Hug Me, I'm Scared, is what was in that book. And what was with the Leslie character. The other thing that surprised me is when she used her yelling voice saying, "You're not my son." I'm like, whoa, what? What would that mean? But anyway, so anyway, my bear fans, like I said before, again, I'll say it again, I highly recommend the song from Rocket Music called Don't Hug Me, I'm Scared, featuring Chewy Cat. Shout out to you, 2D Cat. Shout out to you, Rocket Music. And shout out to you, CD5. And also shout out to you, Dead Meat, for these 3 solid videos. These were super good. And I can't wait to delve into more of the Don't Hug Me, I'm Scared show. Because I feel like this really is a great show. And I highly recommend it to anyone. And go watch my TikTok of me telling you how awesome it was. Even though I just go watch it for yourselves, because you'll be like, oh well, it's just another Sesame Street show. It's not worth my time. No, it is worth your time. Trust me, okay. It's not Sesame Street. I want you to put that thought out of your head, because it's not Sesame Street. They twist it from the first episode, and I was so shocked when they did that. I was like, yo, this is not Sesame Street. And I love that, how they twisted it at the end. So, anyway, my bear fans, this was me, Flakey, just off this reaction video, and as always, just have a great day, brightful day, cheerful day, and I'll see you in the next Flakey Winter Reaction video.